Hi guys, welcome to micro classes. Guys, जो लोग इंग्लिश सब्जेक्ट से इग्नू से एमए कर रहे हैं तो उनको फर्स्ट ईयर और सेकेंड ईयर दोनों ईयर्स उनको असाइनमेंट सबमिट करने होते हैं. तो इंग्लिश जो लोग इंग्लिश फर्स्ट ईयर में है एमए में, तो उनको जो है MEG-1, MEG-2, MEG-3 और MEG-4 के असाइनमेंट सबमिट करने होते हैं. तो मैंने MEG-1 और MEG-2 का असाइनमेंट का वीडियो पहले ही अपलोड कर चुका हूं और आज मैं स्टार्ट करने जा रहा हूं MEG-3 का वीडियो. वन मोर थिंग गाइस, कि अगर आप इस चैनल पे फर्स्ट टाइम आए हैं तो प्लीज़ आप इस चैनल को सब्सक्राइब कर लीजिए, क्योंकि इस चैनल पे आपको UPTET, UPCTET, प्लस UPTCT की तैयारी करने के लिए जो उनके सिलेबस है उस सिलेबस के सारे पॉइंट्स आपको इस चैनल पे मिलेंगे. तो आइए स्टार्ट करते हैं इंग्लिश एमए इग्नू फर्स्ट ईयर MEG-3 का असाइनमेंट. MEG-3 ये ब्रिटिश नावल से संबंधित है और MEG-3 का जो असाइनमेंट है इसमें 5 क्वेश्चन के जवाब देने होते हैं. आइए पहले हम वो देख लेते हैं वो 5 क्वेश्चन हैं कौन कौन से. जो फर्स्ट है, ट्रेस द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द ब्रिटिश नॉवेल ड्यूरिंग द 19th century. जो सेकेंड क्वेश्चन है वो है, वुड इट बी करेक्ट टू से दैट हेथक्लिफ्स डार्क एंड एविल डिस्कस इन द लाइट ऑफ योर अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड एनालिसिस ऑफ वुदरिंग हाइट. जो थर्ड क्वेश्चन है, वुड यू कंसिडर द नॉवेल ग्रेट एक्सपेक्टेशन टू बी द स्टोरी ऑफ पिप्स एजुकेशन इन लाइफ. जो फोर्थ क्वेश्चन है, एग्जामिन डोरोथियाज आइडियाज ऑफ मैरिज इन मिडिल मार्च. जो फिफ्थ क्वेश्चन है MEG-3 असाइनमेंट का वो है, वुड यू एग्री दैट द मेजर कैरेक्टर्स ऑफ द प्राइम ऑफ मिस जीन ब्रॉडी रिफ्लेक्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्टिंग एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ मोरलिटी. ये 5 क्वेश्चन के आंसर देने हैं आपके MEG-3 असाइनमेंट में. तो आइए स्टार्ट करते हैं फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन से. एंसर ऑल क्वेश्चन, इससे पहले का जो असाइनमेंट था उस MEG-2 का, तो उसमें टोटल 9 क्वेश्चन थे जिसमें 5 के आंसर देने थे, लेकिन इसमें 5 क्वेश्चन ही दिए गए हैं और सभी के आंसर देने हैं. तो आइए स्टार्ट करते हैं MEG-3 ब्रिटिश नॉवेल के असाइनमेंट का फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, दैट इज ट्रेस द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ द ब्रिटिश नॉवेल ड्यूरिंग द 19th century. द ग्रेट मैन ऑफ लेटर्स इन द 19th century ब्रिटिश नॉवेल ठाकरे गेव दिस नॉवेल ऑफ मैनर्स अ डीपर सिग्निफिकेंस एंड द लॉफ्टियर आर्टिस्ट एम समवाट कॉरस्पॉन्डिंग टू द बाल्जाक्स ह्यूमन कॉमेडी फॉर पेरिस एंड फॉर फ्रेंच मैनर्स. द इंग्लिश ठाकरे पोर्ट्रेट द वैनिटी फेयर ऑफ लंडन इन लाइफ एंड द कैरेक्टर्स वी हैव मेट इन हिज पेजेस बैक शॉर्प रॉडन क्रॉली लॉर्ड स्टेन जॉस सैडली पेन एंड लॉरा कैप्टन कास्टिगन कॉल न्यूकम एंड क्लाइव वी फील हैव लिव्ड. इन जॉर्ज इलियट्स वर्क द वुमेन सो बोर्ड ब्रूडेड ओवर द इल्यूजन एंड डिस इल्यूजन ऑफ लाइफ विच फाउंड relentless expression in the characterization of Dorothea Brooke and Dr. Lydgate in the Middle March, and the psychological novel of character and analysis of motive was a length born for English speaking world. Mr. George Meredith and Mr. Thomas Hardy, who was it first went over to the local school, though independent and more influenced by continental examples, have worked in similar path since then, and it has been the period of last quarters of century and belong to our own day. English fiction has been divided into 2 sharp schools. The dividing line has the almost seemed to the geographical and national in southern England fiction followed in the wake of the Warwickshire woman. The analysts George Eliot, Scott, Dickens and Thackeray were all discarded as hopelessly out of date and weak sentimental. Mr. George Meredith, Ordeal of the Richard Feverel and his latest work show how terribly in earnest in this portrayal of destiny in the lives and relation of men and women. Mr. Thomas Hardy brought all the powers of his splendid rhetoric and art upon the delineation of tests of the duo. Urbe Villiers, who has maintained was a pure woman faithfully portrayed. There was no capitulation with this gentleman. This doctrine of inheritance and outside environment determining character, this promulgation of the fatalistic bearing of fact and circumstance upon life was sprung over full, complete and hopeless. It was not in the England alone, and the moment had not begun in England. It was with Zola in France, Tolstoy in Russia, and in dramas of Ibsen in Scandinavia and the young Hauptmann in Germany, how they lay bare the structure of society, digging the earth away even from the beneath of the foundation to see what might be hidden. It has been an inevitable step, possibly in the acute scientific and sociological development the world had entered upon in the interest in all problems of human life and social relations. In America, we had no written and no artist who had dared to do the same thing in frankly. Mr. Howells, true, who occupies a leading place in the American letters, has given us the method in his multiplicity of detail, but he has never pushed forward to the same logical result in the terrible distancement and inexorable fatalism of his European models. He has been a lesser imitator of Blazek in phases of Boston and New York life, as Mr. Brander Matthews is in his pictures of New York society. But in striking contrast with the moment, Scotland, perhaps further removed from continental influence, still proved true to the tradition of Walter Scott. North of the Tweed, Robert Louis Stevenson still invoked the zenith of romance and believed that a good story with a plot possessing a throughout placed villain was still worth telling, provided it was endowed with a style of distinction. Other Scott writers likewise lingered on the romantic and gendered side of Scottish life. In depicting manners and character, the sudden protest against naturalism and fatalism, the materialism of circumstances and fact in British literature first made itself destiny felt from Scotland. Came spontaneously and simultaneously from a group of writers born of Scot and native. And not foreign tradition. There was a first of all Stevenson who passing to America and the island of the Pacific ultimately belonged to no race and country and climate but to an altruistic brotherhood of man, and at the moment then the influence of the searching psychology and analysis of Mr. Meredith and Hardy was reaching its height. There sprang up out of the rugged Scotch oil the more sentimental portrait of Scotch life, Ian McLaren's Beside the Bonny Briar Bush and Mr. Barry's A Window in Thrums, the little minister and sentimental Tommy, though literally Mr. Barry has gone over to the enemy with his transplanting from Thrums to London? Guys, this it was first question, and we are going to read the second question. That is, would it be correct to say that Heathcliff's dark and avid disgust in the light of your understanding and analysis of Wuthering Heights? It's the second question of MEG-3 assignment, and let me read this now. Heathcliff is a man of extremes. He hates entirely without reserve, and he loves the same way. He is persuaded of Catherine even into death in excessive, impractical, and even unreal. This fits with the quality of the passion ascribed to him by Emily Bronte. We are not surprised when Heathcliff digs up Catherine's coffin or see her ghost. This is the surest sign that his character has been well developed. He commands a stranger power all through the novel. His primitive behavior is made convincing by the originating him in 18th century slum. After being settled at Wuthering Heights, he immediately begins to cause conflicts in the family. Henry feels cheated when Heathcliff enjoys greater affection of his father. He is used to ill treatment, so he would stand the blows of Henry without crying. He doesn't complain even when he is dangerously ill. He is a favorite of Mr. Earnshaw. Once his pony goes lame, he arbitrarily demands Hindley's pony. He gets it through his influence with Mr. Earnshaw. This was his first test of power, but after the death of Mr. Earnshaw, Hindley tortures him and makes him live with his servant. He deprives him of education and forces him to labor all day with the frame workers. Heathcliff therefore develops undying hatred of Hindley. He prepares plans in his soul of revenge on Hindley when he gets this chance. He takes his revenge with deliberately cruelty. Apart from this passion of revenge, the only thing that moves Heathcliff is his love for Catherine. Heathcliff and Catherine are naturally attracted to each other. They grow more and more reckless and often run away to moors all day to escape Henry's torture. On one such occasion, there is Thurstcross Grange. A dog pounces upon Catherine and the Lintons take her in. Heathcliff is driven off. Heathcliff hates them at first sight of their weakness, but the Catherine is flattered by their attention and impressed by their luxury. Heathcliff now adds Edgar's name to his hit list. Gradually, he hated Fraud Hindley, and Edgar develops into determination to seek revenge on both the families by grabbing their property and destroying them completely. Nelly suggests that he should leave the revenge to God. He says, "God will not have the satisfaction that I shall." Heathcliff overhears Catherine telling Nelly that it would degrade her to marry Heathcliff, so he marries Edgar, though he continues to love Heathcliff. Heathcliff runs away, and after 3 years, when he comes back, he is rich and educated. After his return, Heathcliff's determination to ruin Henry's body and soul becomes devilish. He watches with satisfaction Henry degeneration after his wife's death. He is ready to kill his 2 years old son for the sheer joy of revenge. His hatred of Linton is equally intense. That is why he explained Isabel's foolish fascination for him. He elopes with her and marries her. This is there to know that having Isabelle in power will cause a great pain to Edgar. He also hopes through his marriage to gain ultimately the control of the Linton's property. However, Heathcliff's anger against the Lintons was misdirected. They had no wronged him. It was Catherine who had betrayed his love. His behavior to Isabella revolting in its sadism. Isabella finds that he is a lying friend, a monster, not human being. He himself says, "I have no pity. I have no pity. The more the worms writhe, the more I yearn to crush out their entrails." After Catherine's death, the second generation of Earnshaw, Lintons and Heathcliff grows up into adolescence. However, it is still revenge that dominates Heathcliff. His only interest in his son is to use him and instrument to get control of the Thrushcross Grange. He degrades Hareton to the level of rough, uncivilized boor. Means rough person. He forces young Cathy to marry Linton. He doesn't care for Linton, his own son. When he is dying, he controls all the books of young Cathy. He becomes worse than devil to her, yet he cannot break her spirit. He is not true when he says, "I have done no injustice and I repent of nothing." Actually, his compulsive drive for revenge has exhausted itself as long as hate clip it trim, but the Hareton returns love for hate, and so Heathcliff cannot torture him anymore. More than revenge, it is his love for Catherine that drives him into action. For instance, in the very beginning of the novel, Heathcliff begs Catherine's spirit to come in after Lookwood's dream. Her marriage with Edgar makes him bitter with frustration. It is only then that he acquires wealth and education to compete with Edgar. His love for Catherine, despite his marriage, is intense. When he learns about Catherine's illness, he blames Edgar for it. His torture of Isabelle is a kind of revenge of the suffering of Catherine. His passion for Catherine is naked display of passion. He widely blames Catherine for her fate. However, he declared that their love is so great that nothing that God of Saturn could inflict would have parts us. He wishes Catherine to haunt him even after her death and never to leave him alone, because I cannot live without my soul. He stops torturing Horton and young Cathy because their eyes remind him of Catherine's eye. He bribes the sextons to open Catherine's coffin and to open the side of his coffin when he buried along with her. He threatens Nelly to come back and haunt her if he is not buried next to the Catherine. This his whole being is moved only by Catherine's love of by hatred of those whom he blames of his separation from the Catherine. Third question hai, would you consider the novel Great Expectation to be the story of Pip's education in life? Aiye dekhte hain. As a child, Pip received almost no formal education. Kuch points se dekh lete hain. Mr. Wopold's great aunt school is almost entirely useless. Next point, he acquires some basic literary and few random facts from Bitty, an experience which puts him well beyond the almost illiterate Joy. After he received news of expectation, his education is rapidly advanced. Herbert Pocket teaches him social manners appropriate to his new status. Next, he reads with Matthew Pocket and Mr. Pocket with other students and thus begins to study much more profitably and systematically. Next, he appears to pursue a regular course of reading into adult life. Educational and social class. In the novel, education is closely linked to class. Next point, Pip's education ambition arise from his wish to more worthy of Estella. With Matthew and Herbert Pocket, he begins to acquire the education through appropriate for a gentleman. Next, Matthew Pocket's other student, although middle class, clearly needs some remedial education to fit them either for university education or for a professional role. Next, MEG-3 perceives that the gently companion is able to use his education to his advantage in the courtroom. Let us see in now detail. In Great Expectation, the representation of the relation between master and servant are more complicated and hence much less idealized than in many of Dickens' earlier fiction. This complexity arises first as a result of Pip's education and upward mobility, and second, to the heir of secretary in the novel. Had Pip stayed in his old life of blacksmithing, he might well have married good-natured Betty, who comes to work as love in help of for Jock and Mrs. Gregory after the latter assault and consequent paralysis. But symbolic of his status as a gentleman, Pip requires a manservant, so he says with a degree of self-irony, he started a boy in boots, top boots, in bondage and slavery, to whom it might have been said, "I passed my days." Pip suggested that because he is young and inexperienced in the role of master, he creates a bit of monster in paper, whom he dubs the Avenger. His servant at Barnard's Inn, after the expense of purchasing the boy's livery, Pip confided to the reader that he had to find him a little to do and great deal to eat, and with the both of those horrible requirements, he haunted my existence. On other occasion, he puts the irony of the power reversal in ever starker terms, a better proof of the severity of my bondage to the taskmaster. The Avenger could scarcely be afforded than the degrading shift to which I was constantly driven to find him employment. In addition to the wage class mobility complicate the master-servant relationship in Great Expectation, the numerous secrets that character in the novel are keeping also give rise a complex depictions of those uneasy power relations. The grown-up Estella returning to visit Miss Havisham, he is told to come without her maid because the recklessly old woman has a sensitive horror of being talked of such people, as Estella explains to Pip. Similarly, Mr. Zager, the liar, also is extremely cautious in his hiring of servants. When Pip and his friends are invited to dinner at the liar's house, he lets them in, and throughout dinner, Pip noticed he kept everything under his own hand and distributed everything himself, using a dump waiter near his seat, a table that is employed no butler. In fact, Jagger's housekeeper is the only servant who appears. Wemmick describes her as a resembling a wild beast tamed, which, as the novel eventually discloses, has to do with the Jagger's knowledge of her secret history. Though Dickens' late fiction do not abandon entirely the faithful servant figure, in Boffin's In Our Mutual Friends come immediately to mind. This is in bracket. In great expectation and though Pip's first person narration, Dickens unfailingly treats servant with the disdain and even aversion, Pip's attitude alongside his acknowledged guilty for the deserting Joa and his revulsion of Magfish forms the novel's complicity realized exploration of class antagonism as well as its critique of class snobbery. आइए अब स्टार्ट करते हैं MEG-3 असाइनमेंट का फोर्थ क्वेश्चन, दैट इज एग्जामिन डोरोथियाज आइडियाज ऑफ मैरिज इन मिडिल मार्च. फ्रॉम द वेरी बिगनिंग ऑफ मिडिल मार्च वी सेड दैट डोरोथिया हैज सेट स्टैंडर्ड ऑफ हर लव लाइफ दैट सी रिफ्यूजेज टू चेंज डिस्पाइट what anyone else says and despite the folly of her ideologies that surrounded her conception of love. From the book first, the reader immediately comes to the realization that Dorothea's marriage to Mr. Casaubon is driven by the prospect that through Casaubon she will become educated and will serve as a usual wife to him. It is doubtful that any reader would consider Dorothea's reason of marriage satisfactory because it is made clear in book first that Dorothea will all of her eagerness to know that truth of life retain very childlike ideas about marriage. The really delightful marriage must be that where your husband was sort of a father and could teach you even Hebrew if you wished it. It is evident that Dorothea determines to stick to her philosophy of life. Marriage Casaubon for every other reason aspects of love. Eventually, throughout the various book of Middlemarch, Dorothea realized that her marriage to Casaubon is not what she expected and very incomplete. Not only does she not receive what she wants from him, but he doesn't receive what she needs. And what that is what every woman needs in a relationship, romanticism. This the ideal that Dorothea processes clash with the realities of the real world. Furthermore, Dorothea is so interested in reform for those living in the poverty that she cannot barely see that there needs to be a change within her own personal life. In book 4th of Middlemarch, he eventually begins to see that through the will Lady's law, Dorothea's character is being transformed and being made anew because of the love that Lady's law show of her. Dorothea's will about her husband changed because she realizes that it's not the perfect emblem of a husband that the envisioned him to be. At one point, Dorothea is described as having a light bulb go off in her head in relation to her husband's relationship. Feel that was like a sudden letting in of daylight, waking her from the previous stupidity and incuriousness, self-abhorred ignorance about her husband's relation to others. While Dorothea continuously attempts to produce change in the lives of others as well as Lady's laws, she remains blind to the change that need to take more place in her own life. Unconsciously and unbeknownst to Dorothea throughout her talk with Larissa, his love for her gradually begins to peel away at the layers covering his unloved heart, thus inducing a change of heart that is yet to come. Moreover, Dorothea's proposal to her husband for social change is a sign that a personal change is taking place within her. Ironically, every bit of change that we see within Dorothea, including her transformation from a young creature that worshipped Casaubon to the critical wife, stems from Lady's law. Importantly, Dorothea believes that by desiring what is perfectly good, even when we do not quite know what is and cannot do what we should, we are part of the divine power against evil, winding the skirt of light and making the struggle with darkness narrower. Dorothea's religious beliefs simply underneath the surface that in order for the perfectly good to arise, a change must take a place. The only good and perfect thing that Dorothea needs in his heart, desire for true love. If this serves as true philosophy that she holds strong to within her inner self, then it is only a matter of time before she realizes her own personal change that will inevitably take place. All in all, when it comes to reform, Dorothea has strong belief in regard to a social change. Where is any change within her own personal life remains to be seen. Her selfness causes her to look past her own needs and to look toward those of her dear cousin, young lady Shla. Although she has strong belief and ideas when it comes to social reform, and her eyes cannot see the personal change that is needed within her own life. Eventually, Dorothea's aching heart will cause her to open up her eyes to the real change that need to take place. In conclusion, although Dorothea welcomes social change to better someone else's life, it takes her a while to grasp when a personal change is needed. Will Dorothea begin to question her marriage with Casabin and imagine a possible for future with Ladishla? Will the reform to the ideas of her mind or the ideas of her heart? MEG-3 ka jo 4 जो फिफ्थ क्वेश्चन है वो देखते हैं. वो है, वुड यू एग्री दैट द मेजर कैरेक्टर ऑफ द प्राइम ऑफ मिस जिन ब्रोटी रिफ्लेक्ट कॉन्फ्लिक्टिंग एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ मोरलिटी. आइए इसके बारे में हम लोग डिटेल में पढ़ते हैं कि स्पार्क्स कैरेक्टर वी फाइंड अ इंटीरियराइज्ड. दिस मीन्स दैट दे आर इन्वॉल्व्ड इन अ सर्च फॉर अ सेल्फ दैट commentate both personal fulfillment and political or social claims. These characters are usually guided by personal obsession that turn their life and into channels of self righteous imagination and bring about their destruction. Miss Brody is one such character. As an eccentric spinster and a school teacher, she has made a fine art out of private judgment of character and specialized in organizing the lives of the Brody set according to her own insights. She negates and scoffs at any inclusion of the team spirit which is in her eyes. Contravenes individuals' freedom. She thinks that as far as her protégés are concerned, she is providence who can see their beginning and end. Her indomitable personality resists all those who question her unorthodox method. This impression of her power is also carried by her pupils, who are unquestioning and uncritical, absorbing all she says. In fact, they go to the extent of being hostile to all who intrude in the classroom and seem to challenge the ways of Miss Brody. She derives her power from the two sources. One emanates from those parents who could be trusted not to lodge complaints about the more advanced and seditious aspects of her educational policy. The other was the personal education that she shares with the Brody set, where their parents hesitate to take them. Miss Brody was a willing escort. She initiated them into the world of art by telling them of the feats of Italian Renaissance painters. They learn to appreciate not only operas, but also understood the temperament of devoted artists like Anna Pavlova and Sibyl Thorndike. By inviting them up for meals and walks, Miss Brody included in the girls a sense of indebtedness which she used to her advantage whenever she was a confrontation with school authorities. In moments of crisis, the counted on their moral support, and her cliques becomes her greatest source of self-protection. The devastating aspects of Miss Brody holds over the girls is seen in the machination and manipulations regarding the future of especially two girls, Rose and Sandy. Manipulating situation in order to make Rose Mistress Lillard's lover. She identifies Rose's instincts as the quality that would particularly appeal to the art master. Then she tries to convince Sandy that with her insight, Sandy would be the ideal informant on the Lloyd-Rose liaisons. It is Sandy who refuses to oblige and thwart the teacher's plan. Miss Brody's relationship with the Lothar also cannot stand the test of time. It starts on a note of deceit and fraud, as Mr. Lothar is only a smoke screen to camouflage Miss Brody's passion for the Mr. Lloyd. Her girls believe that she is only interested in restoring him back to the pink of health after going through a domestic upheaval that begins with the departure of his housekeepers and continued inefficiency by her replacement, the care sister. She keeps Mr. Lothar on tenter hooks and then begins to treat him with the indifference, believing all the while that she could marry him whenever he pleased. And when he gets engaged to Mr. Lockhart, the science mistress, there is a great sense of shock humanization. Miss Brody's ideology also let her down at a time when war clouds are gathering over Europe. For a second time, her admiration for fascist symbols like Mussolini and Hitler. Strike and discordant and false news about her in people's minds. It is these beliefs that make it easy for Sandy to betray her. Miss Brody's own fascistic leaning can be seen in her endeavor to cultivate and thrust her own passions on the minds of her special girls. She looks upon the girls' guides as a rival group out to disband the broad set and make clear her dislikes and suspicion of them. She fails to understand that she is indulging himself at the expense of the freedom of others. She commits the error playing God, assembling that everyone she chooses will fall under her control. This is a threatening aspect of her personality which sums up the abuse of power. Ultimately, she reduced a pathetic creature who loves her power and cannot understand why those individuals whom she had nursed so carefully let her down. She herself becomes the most damaged victim of her misplaced confidence. The paths of her downfall and the importance of her defeat is conveyed through a description of her setting. She wailed and betrayed in her long received dark Moscow's coat at her blind groping for the real identity of her betrayer. And the character who exhibited propensities of psychological and moral growth is Sandy. She, like Miss Brody, is involved in a search for self which leads leads her through many diverse experiences and climates in her taking the voice of a nun. Sandy is, however, she fall created by spark to upset Brody. She is seen in undertake a personal mission that initially questioned the defies and ultimately betrays Miss Brody for what she is. From the very outset, Sandy begins to investigate Mr. Brody's possible weak point, and she relies on her experience, images, and conscience to her in the quest. From the very beginning, she only tentatively assents Miss Brody's ideology and doctrine. She initially disrupts class to getting to tell Mary to give an incorrect answer, walks with her head bent back, looking at the ceiling and telling Miss Brody that she is imitating the great actress Sybil Thorndike, and deliberately chooses to stay away from Miss Brody's tea party after a walk throughout the Edinburgh slums. All this is done to gauge Mr. Brody's reaction to settle from the defiance, and Sandy is often told that one day she will go too far by exceeding the limits given by the teacher to her girls. With the passage of time, Sandy experience of Miss Brody domination over the girls is supplemented by images that reinforce the opinion when Jenny reports seeing Mr. Brody being kissed by Mr. Lloyd. In the art room after school, Sandy begins to see the sexual aspect of Mr. Brody's love life, what until then had been confined to the romanticized tales that she and Lenny wrote. It's confirmed in Sandy's mind. Proof of it comes later when she is the only one in the Brody set who is able to identify the images of the teacher in any figure and Mr. Lord claims to paint. Sandy thus understand that Miss Brody's passions and sexual yearning for the married a teacher calls never is fulfilled. It was a result transferred to Mr. Lothar, with whom she only played carrot of love. With Emily Joy's tragic death, while the girl was on the way to fight up General Franco in the Spanish Civil War, Sandy's consciousness is jolted into action. Her tentative ascent to Miss Brody's doctrine is transformed to descent. She reveals Brody's fascist view to Miss Mackie, and her action constitute authorical agreement with the character's appraisal. Spark all his herself in some expert with the Sandy, whom then enters convents and published a psychological trade site called The Transfiguration of the Commonplace. Though Sandy is seen to have meted out justice, she herself is not a figure totally redeemed. In too many ways, she bears an interior resemblance to Miss Brody, and we are made to see her actions as none. Her sense of personal guilt and revenge haunt her and reflected in her pictures as Sister Helena clutching the bars of the convent's enclosure and look out at a world that seems to have passed her by. At the fag end of their lives, both Miss Brody and Sandy are figures of isolation. Miss Brody is not burdened by the guilt of betrayal. She is only shaken by the knowledge that she has been betrayed, and she dies never knowing the true reasons of her downfall. Sandy, as Sister Helena, lives and archives fame, but it is always aware of cruelly betraying a woman to whom she could never recount the past. Both women simultaneously arouses our compassion and outrageous. They stand out as a figure who dare to defy convention in personal and public life. Their weakness lies in them being unable to perceive and counter their destructive capabilities. तो गाइज ये था मेरा आज का वीडियो, आपको कैसा लगा प्लीज़ आप कमेंट करके बताइएगा, और वन मोर थिंग गाइज कि प्लीज़ चैनल सब्सक्राइब करना आप मत भूलिएगा। तो थैंक यू गाइज, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर वॉचिंग दिस वीडियो।